30 seconds, okay. Okay, so it says we are live on Facebook. It took us a few minutes. So good afternoon, Jerry. I'm really happy to see you. As I always say, you are always so beautiful and so nice and put together, still so charming that I don't know how you do it. To be very honest, I don't know how you handle that. So for the people that are looking at us, we are starting a series in which we try to interact with amazing people that are our Stop TB champions, but also their lives, their careers that are making them famous and amazing. They decided to spend some of that on TB or more on that. And what a great opportunity to start this series with one of the greatest female advocates for TB and MDR-TB, a celebrity in her own country, Jerry. And we will follow with every week with another famous person from countries. But for us, South Africa means a lot. Jerry means a lot. So we kick with Jerry this series. So Jerry, if you can introduce yourself for people that are here with us.
Thank you so much, Luchika, my awesome, crazy, and wonderfully passionate friend is how I always describe you. You and I are both equally passionate about tuberculosis. I remember my husband saying, I don't understand how you people can talk about lung disease over dinner so much. and it's because it's a very important cause. It's probably more important for you and I and the TB community now, maybe even more than ever, to be focused inwardly on an issue that we hold so dear to our hearts. I'm a TB survivor. I had extrapulmonary TB in my womb many, many years ago, and I went on to 9 months of TB treatment, and even though I didn't have pulmonary TB, I felt it necessary to become a voice for TB in my country because of the stigma related to it, and helping people understand that someone who, as you say, is as well put together as me, speaks as well as me, has the popularity and the fame that I have in my own country, and the reputation politically and socially, to have someone like me speak out makes others more comfortable with acknowledging their TB, with getting the medications and going to clinics for their TB. And in South Africa, I've been fortunate, I think, Luchika, to have a government that really supported TB sufferers and actually went that extra mile. And I hope we can continue to do so in the future. COVID-19, though, I don't know if you'll agree with me, has unfortunately and scarily shifted people's attention a little, and I'm really concerned about that, Luchika.
Yes, so that's absolutely true, and South Africa was, and I hope will remain a model for providing care for its people, in people with HIV, people with TB, a lot in terms of MDR-TB, having a lot of bold movements. And I think also very honestly discussing about COVID and trying to do the best for the COVID-19 as well. But as you rightly said, I think when you look at it globally, the attention, everyone is basically doing or thinking just about COVID. And, you know, I think after the initial shock, it's very important for all of us to realize that, as you said, people are suffering and dying of other things as well. And yeah, make sure that there is no disruption on that. And yes. I don't know exactly how it is being organized in South Africa right now, but in several countries, including in my own countries, normal health services are paralyzed, are not happening. So except COVID and some very, very, very high emergencies, the rest is kind of turn back and go home and come later. only that this later is becoming much, much delayed and so on. So you are in a house confinement, Jerry. You are in lockdown as well. So how do you handle that, and how do you feel your fellow citizens and your I know you are very active with civil society engagement and communities. So how do you feel it's happening for TB and also for people in their lives?
So I am homebound. One of the reasons, Luchika, that I am homebound is because my 81-year-old mother lives with us. And because of her, we've elected to spend as much time quarantined inside of the house because of her age and because of her vulnerability, high blood pressure, diabetes. So for her, because, you know, taking care of putting on your mask or your gloves or whatever, it's not just about protecting you. It's also about protecting, being sensitive to those around you. So yes. But you know, I love to chat. I've been doing a lot of online chats. For us, in terms of guidelines, one of the things that we did notice in the beginning, as you rightly say, is that services were being shifted. Lab services were being shifted from TB testing to COVID testing. And I think once the dust settled last week or the week before, in three of our provinces, we started doing dual testing for TB and COVID-19 together. So in three of the high burden provinces, we have started to ensure that TB screenings are being done at the screening stations, but also at home for both COVID-19 and tuberculosis. We can't drop the ball on that. We live in a high burden country, and I'm glad that our health department is really on the front line of getting that done.
This is amazing. So I don't know how many people are watching us, but this is very great job done, because this is where we should all go. And again, countries should learn from South Africa. I think there are some initiatives similar in India and in Pakistan. And I heard even in my own country, in Romania, trying to do TB and COVID in the same time, but the scale that you are doing it, I think it's much higher than before. Are people, you know, so I know you are in touch with the civil society colleagues and so on. So did they share with you some of the challenges that they see a lot happening or, you know, that they are facing these days?
Some of the challenges that they are facing is that not enough people are actually showing up for their ARVs or even for their TB medications, because people are afraid to leave home. And because of the first level of restrictions, I'm not certain that countries were thinking about those who needed to pick up their medications and those who needed to get to doctors. And so some of the concerns were that not enough people were showing up for treatments, and how then the civil service, civil societies were saying, how can we assist in ensuring that these people get to service centers, that they are prioritized, not just for the screenings, but those who already present and those who have been on their medications for a while. So the civil society organizations have worked hard at ensuring that we go back to, do you remember when home-based care was really a thing? And so they've begun to reintroduce home-based care, so to speak, to ensure that those who are suffering, those who are HIV positive and those who are positive for TB are still getting the required treatment and care that they require. And that's a big step. I know that civil society in South Africa this week, the South African National Council of AIDS Council, is also meeting with our president and our deputy president to truly push home the message. And you know, our president has backed us for a long time since the UN meetings to ensure that they put their money where their mouths are.
Yeah, I think that's very important. And indeed, President Ramaphosa was very useful, including for the UN high-level meeting in pushing forward the targets and the agenda. And, you know, two things that I want to say. One is, for people that are online, they can ask any question if they want. The second is that on the why are we here, and we look slightly worried, is because, as you, Jerry, know, for a long time we are in this battle. And finally, you know, over the last, we constructed step by step and slowly.
Yes, yes, over years.
Yes, so I will ask you to tell us a few things over the work that you did over the years and all the efforts that you put into this. And we were now at a better place in a way because we had the UN high-level meeting targets. We felt that there is more engagement from the countries and the more engagement from the leadership in different parts of the world to make us ready to close to reach our targets of 2022, then hopefully to NTB. With the COVID, we did this modeling in which colleagues from Imperial College, Avenir Health, and John Hopkins modeled the TB situation and the impact of mitigation measures. And it shows that it rolls us back to the years 2013 to 2015, the years when we were, you know, a bit younger, but also, you know, all the efforts that we did over these years, we will see them lost. So we are very concerned. But Jerry, you did a lot with TB World, you know, to push us forward. So if you can just, you know, share a bit of your own life experience from the moment you got sick, and also, you know, some of the efforts that were done to push this agenda forward.
So I've been working in TB and with the South African government for almost three government terms, so 10, maybe 15 years. And initially, it was all about stigma. No one wanted to arrive for medications. We really had to do what we could. About 12 years ago, I remember we started a campaign that really, really did impact everyone. It was called Kick TB. We went to schools across the country. We spoke to thousands and thousands of children, teaching them the symptoms of TB, encouraging them to go home and speak to their households. You can't, in South Africa, you can't just say parents, because here, grandmothers and aunts and uncles, they all live in one enclosed space. And Kick TB was really a way, if you remember years ago, when children were being taught in schools how to go home and say, "Mom, Dad, wear a seatbelt." We used the same "Mom, Dad, smoking is bad for you," when they used to teach children that in school. That's what Kick TB was meant to be. "You're coughing, Mom. Get tested, get tested, get tested." And so we did that with the Soccer World Cup in South Africa. It really did make an impact. It really did help. And we started seeing that communities, government were becoming more active in TB. And we saw great growth. I mean, Minister Aaron Motsoaledi, when he was the head of the Department of Health, such a passionate man when it came to TB, to the extent that he became a fundamental part of the Stop TB partnership campaign. So no, I hold my head when you say we're going to regress. But what does that mean for us, Luchika? It means that we're going to have to use new mechanisms to ensure that this regression doesn't maintain itself for too many years. We can't take the same amount of time to get from 2013 back to 2020. We have 2 years, I'm saying. I'm giving us 2 years, and you know what I mean, to get from 2013 back to where we need to be.
Yes. Yes, I totally agree with that. And indeed, it will be a disaster if it is for us to go you know, back and forth like that, and we cannot accept the thing. So, you know, there are people that are looking at us which are not necessarily from the TB space. How are your days going? Going to the, you know, you are a mother, a daughter, a wife, a partner, a friend. So, you know, wondering how are your days going these days?
Well, you spend a lot of time in the kitchen. I have one daughter at home. My husband's in the vehicle industry, so he's in essential services. And so he's managed to be back at work for about a week and a half now. The days are hard. I'm a mountain climber. I'm a marathon runner. And these were two things that I was unable to do. And so from that perspective, it's been challenging, but I've been very much focused on speaking and counseling people with TB, counseling young people who are, in fact, young and living alone. You know, when you're a mature person living alone, there are ways mentally that you can deal with issues. But when you're young and living alone and you feel isolated, it's a different set of emotions that you go through. And so I've just been kept busy with counseling and chatting to individuals. I'm very active in the church. In fact, I don't think you know, I was ordained as a pastor.
Oh my God.
Quite recently. And that's a lot of work, just for the record.
Yes.
So it's been a very busy time, even just being home, because people still have needs that one needs to take care of.
Oh, absolutely. I didn't know this with the pastor. So that's an amazing opportunity. And it's also an amazing platform.
Yes.
To share some messages, because I think, you see, speaking like Lucipa with Jerry here, the fact that we know so little about COVID and a lot of the messages going out are very confusing, you know? So we confuse, you know, one day we say, not we, me and you, but in general, because the COVID is so new and there is not enough evidence and data to really have a clarity, the questions are more than the certitude. You know, I spoke somebody once with someone who said, can you tell me what we know for sure about COVID and what we don't know? And when I started saying what we don't know was almost half an hour of what we don't know and very little of what we know. And because of that, we get confusing messages to people, you know, wear a mask, which we believe in it, but there are a lot of people saying, don't wear a mask. You get immunity, then a lot of people say, we don't get immunity. The disease lasts for that, the disease doesn't last for that. So, you know, you need a ventilator, you need an anticoagulant and so on. So it is very difficult, but we are dealing with tuberculosis, and for a long time we dealt with TB, and it took us a lot of efforts to arrive at this level.
There is something I'd like us to talk about just from your perspective as part of the organization. Luchika, I remember at the beginning of COVID when, you know, all we knew was if you're coughing, if you're showing certain symptoms, that way in the beginning, what are we talking about, January, February? I remember putting up a picture of a school visit I did in one of our provinces where we were teaching all the little children how to cough. And it's a picture of 100 children, I took it from the front, 100 children doing this. And I posted it, and I got a little bit of pushback, a little bit of criticism for saying, oh, so now you're telling us to cough on our clothes. You know, clothes can be a carrier. You're giving us bad information. And I had to go back and I had to say, this was what we taught children to do to ensure that they don't cough on their mates. I think it's still valid today.
Yes.
That we need to be careful that we don't become, that we don't, you know, spread COVID. And I got a lot of pushback. And I just, you know, and then I know that the WHO, and I don't know how vocal Stop TB has been on just helping people understand the value of don't cough on other people, you know, and whether it's still relevant.
Yes. So actually, Jerry, you brought here two, three very important points. First, you said for a long time, we should have known that when you cough and is and you have not a mask, or, you know, you don't have a handkerchief or a tissue, you do this. You don't cough in your hands. Huh? And that is very relevant. And, you know, it's very interesting. You remember there are all of these things on social media saying that we were thinking that in the year 2020, we will fly in a car, while what we spend time is telling people how to cough and how to wash their hands, for God's sake. But these are indeed, as you say, things that for a long time we tried to push from the TB side and so on, but it's just now their utility. So first point is, yes, it's very valid, because rather than coughing in your hands, it's better to do it this way. Coughing in your hands, obviously all the germs will be on your hands, and whatever you will touch, elevator, doors, and so on, will then be spread. It's of course not the ideal solution, but we have to also be realistic that not everyone, in the moment you cough or sneeze, you have immediately a handkerchief or something to cover. You might not even have it with you. So that's one. The second thing, washing the hands is remaining extremely important as well. And I know that it's also not very easy, but it is an important piece. And indeed, for a long time, people didn't know for how long you wash your hands and stuff like that, and so on. The third point is on the mask and all the debates with mask or without the mask. And I will, you know, and I'm happy we are having this discussion, because a lot of people are fabulating about it and so on, and it's not very clear. The mask is extremely useful, especially in the places where, you know, it's a closed environment. You go by bus, you go by train, you are in an office in which you have a colleague near you. And, you know, as an example, I had a mask, and I was in a shop a few days ago, and I think somebody made, you know, when you have like an allergy and stuff like that, and you feel like sneezing like five times and coughing in the same time in row quickly. And I was wearing a mask, which was really good. But I have to say that nobody else around me was wearing a mask. So they would have protected themselves better if they had, if I would have spread anything. But on the other hand, they all turned, of course, when you hear somebody coughing or sneezing these days, it used to be, God bless you, now is go fuck yourself, because everyone is... of what, yeah, you people turned. And if I would have not have a mask, I think I would have been beaten to death. But I think they were all, when they saw they wear a mask, they were not having, they relaxed. Now, you, Jerry, might know, but people might not know, we have, as part of Stop TB, a working group on infection control. And we are planning to start, and you know, we'll need your help and of others to share that widely. These people are experts on the masks. They are experts on these disinfectants. They are experts on UV lamps. They are experts on this. So we will do, with all of them, weekly seminars about all these things that we have with people that we used to have for TB a lot, because TB is an airborne disease. And you know very well, it might not affect in all people the lungs, but the main way of spreading is through the air. So that's why masks and disinfectants and UV and all this hygiene of cough, as Jerry, you said, was all the time on our agenda. So we will have weekly webinars, including how to put a mask and how to take a mask and what mask is surgical, what mask is paper, what mask is cloth. You know, people are asking some questions sometimes that I don't know what to even say because of the fact that people are so unclear. You know, I heard somebody saying, I'm taking my mask and I am putting it in my pocket and then I will leave it there for 5 days and I will wear it again after 5 days. Is there any value? Somebody said, I'm putting it in the sun. Somebody said, I'm putting it in the oven. And, you know, there are all these things. So we will try and obviously answer to all of them things there. So I see that there are, so we will have these webinars and we will announce them in this space because I think it's very useful. But now in the meantime, we have few questions there. So I think, Jerry, I think we can both take all the questions.
Okay.
The three of them, because, you know, but maybe you start in whatever order you want with these three questions that we have, and then I will answer as well from my perspective.
Okay, so can you read out that first one? I'm kind of looking at it upside down. I think
okay. Okay, so no problem. So maybe we start with, do you see any added value of dual screening for TB and COVID? Should it be recommended? And if yes, based on what? So I can give, a stop TB perspective on that. And then Jerry, whatever you know from the South African team, the answer is yes. It is based on the, I will tell you the what is based on. First is that for a long time, the TB community developed systems for active case finding in which you go in a community, either with health workers, either with a van, to check for symptoms. So, in that occasion, you basically park the van outside of in a neighborhood. You announce in advance that you come, and then people are coming and getting tested. They get an X-ray. They can get a gene expert test for sputum smear. They can get a blood test, then a different type of consultation. You can use that for COVID as well, of course, protecting measures and everything, infection control and stuff, because a lot of people with COVID and TB have similar symptoms. Not very high fever, some fever can be also missing in both diseases. In both you lose weight, in both you have a lot of people report night sweats for COVID as well as for TB. Cough, which is a dry cough, you don't have a productive cough like the one you have in bronchopneumonia or in the smoker's cough. It's a very dry, annoying cough. These are very common. Huh? So you can have, you go there, and if people follow very strictly the algorithm, where you in touch with somebody, where you in contact with somebody with COVID or stuff, and you say no, then in a lot of places, if they are not thinking of TB as well, they send people home. And it happens in many countries now. People are sent home saying, okay, take some algocalmin, whatever, paracetamol, because this is not COVID. Yes, but if it is TB, and we from TB know very well, sending somebody home now in the confinement is really, really bad because he will infect with TB all the others around him. So yes, it's based on the fact that both symptoms and the way that you do the screening and diagnosis for both TB and COVID are very similar. So that's why it's very important that we have, we try to push as much as possible the double and dual testing. I don't know if you, Jerry, you want to add to this one first question, and then I can go.
What I need to add is that because we've been, the mindset of the medical community has shifted so much, please remember that that person you're sending home, if they have those symptoms, they now have active TB. And so if we are not in the mindset that we must test for both, and as I said, thankfully, three provinces in South Africa are now screening for both. And I felt it was important to press people to do both, because remember, all of our screening mechanisms for TB had now been converted for COVID. That means which of our screening mechanisms are now taking care of TB? And so, yes, the two must be taken care of together, because the lower the immune system, the more likely someone is to contract COVID. Those who are living with HIV, if they are ill, depending on their blood count, yes, they are vulnerable to COVID. You cannot exclude the two from each other. So if to anyone out there, if it seems as though Luchika and I are so focused on TB when there is so much COVID going around, I am going to put it out there and I will take the criticism, Luchika. I'm going to say, yes, there is so much COVID out there, but there is so much more TB out there. And if you don't take care of both, I went to bed last night thinking, our TB sufferers, what about them? How many of them will then become COVID-19 positive? You know, we have millions of them around the world in comparison with those who have succumbed to COVID-19. So yes, Luchika, I will continue to advocate for the TB sufferer. And yes, to that question, we must take care of them together.
Thank you so much, Jerry, for this passion. We have some more questions to answer. One is, how have we been coping with the lockdown? So I'll say just two, three words from me, and then if you have anything else to add to what we said, how we personally cope. You'll see, I live in Geneva, but my family is in Romania. My parents are in Romania. They are pretty senior, and they are alone in a village in Romania in a lockdown situation. So from one angle, I should say nothing because I am in Geneva, okay, in Switzerland. I have a very good, solid roof over my head. I'm here with my son. I have access to internet, to food and water and sanitation and everything. So I should say nothing, but is not everything just that, is also your peace of mind. And I'm very stressed for my family and friends, and to a big extent to my friends back at home, because it's not easy. And in Romania, I don't think is the COVID the biggest problem. The way the political situation and the government is dealing with the COVID probably creates more complications than the COVID itself. To people's life. I'm not speaking against the lockdown. I'm speaking about the way how these mitigation measures are communicated and implemented. But I hate the situation. I am a person going out. I like to be in touch with people. So I hate being so remotely connected, just virtually. It's lovely because I see some people. I didn't see Jerry in a while. So I'm happy that we are in touch, but I'm not coping fantastically well, to be very honest. Do you want to say some words, Jerry, on you personally with dealing with the lockdown?
I spoke about my personal situation a little earlier, but let me just emphasize, I'm surrounded by my family. Like you, I have a good life in South Africa, having had a public career as a celebrity and so on. I was able to create a home with all the comforts that I require. Groceries are being delivered. I've got vegetables in the garden, etc. However, my concern for our people in South Africa, most of them working in the informal settlement, meaning that they are completely dependent on people who pass by for resources. People buy out of the informal markets here. Our people work not necessarily on salary, but on wages that they are not making. So food parcels are being delivered to as many members of our community from foundations, charities, as well as the government, actually. The government has also added a bit of money to those who are living on social welfare, a little extra social welfare. We have a few stimulus packages. Our president has been really good at looking at the system and saying, just from government, we have a billions coming from government to ensure into communities and small businesses to keep things together. But I think there's going to be those who suffer a long time. If you think about my industry, the entertainment industry, I don't think they qualify, Luchika, for any one of these stimulus packages. How does a musician go and ask for a stimulus package? So I'm really concerned about large parts of our society in South Africa. And my family and I have been figuring out how we can help. And you know, Luchika, for me, it's very interesting because I think far ahead. And sorry to say, but I worry that the people who are helping now, when things end, they won't have the time to help after. And
Yes.
that's when we are going to have to set things in motion.
Yes. So we have 8 10 minutes 8 minutes left of this. We have one more question related to the impact that the lockdown, if you feel it had on South Africa health services and TB services, if there is any impact that you observed or you think exists. And while you think of that, I just want to say that South Africa for me means a lot. It started with a lot of you. And it started with, it continued with obviously Minister Motsoaledi and his team. It continues now with the minister and as well the team that he has over there, as well as the president, Jorgen Pillay, a lovely friend, and Harry Hausler, as well as the amazing group of TB Proof and all the activists that are there. And I just want to say that the TB Proof, together with the TB Task group, they are working on the on a research to look at the if there is any reality on the BCG vaccination having a role in the COVID. And they are it's very strange that in these days when so much money seems to be fundraised at global level for COVID, you know, we speak of billions mobilized, we speak of Lady Gaga doing concerts and so on, the South African group is looking to fundraise or fund it from their own pockets. So my head is exploding. So I will do whatever it takes to help them. And, you know, I hope some people hearing us will be more interested to help on that because it's a great merit for them to try to get the evidence on BCG that is having on COVID. So, but with that, I want to make sure that you have a bit of time to reflect over if you see the disturbance on the TB services in South Africa because of the lockdown. And then to ask you, a final reflection on what would you like to see happening, let's say from June onwards, or you know, like what will be your hope? You know, I mean, I know it's difficult.
Yeah,
If it was that you have a magic.
I think with regards to the conversation on how we're all coping here, I think our big concern probably is the weakening of the supply chain and the shortages that we might experience if this goes on for too long, as you can imagine, because we're not just speaking about COVID, we're speaking about chronic medications, we're speaking about ARVs, all these necessary medications. Again, I'm going to put it out there that if the medications for those living with HIV, those with chronic illnesses, those with TB, if we're unable to get those medications to people, again, that is a global dilemma, second to none. And because there are more people with those conditions than they are with COVID at this point. So that's really a thing. Trying to get the PPEs, we're struggling with the same things the global medical community is struggling with, trying to get PPEs out to people. With regards to BCG, yes, I know that there are a group of people working very hard in South Africa to ensure that that we can get that to people. In fact, yesterday there was a comment that we have such a great need for BCGs. You'll tell everybody what that is, but we have such a great need for BCGs in South Africa. Why aren't we producing our own? Why aren't we ensuring that the supply chain is local? I think that's going to be a big conversation after June. It's going to be, why are we as countries so dependent on imports? If this happens again, what happens to our people? That's going to become a huge conversation, and not just in the medical arena, so many arenas. But when it comes to saving our people, why are we so dependent on India and other countries to ensure that our medications are made available?
Yeah, so 2 points. I fully agree with you on the looking forward and re-looking at countries' own reliance on their own system and capacities to produce the and to have available basic and to be able to cover the basic needs. I totally agree with you. I think everywhere people realize that due to for economic reasons, everything was outsourced kind of overseas to be produced. And then if overseas is not possible, you are stuck. So I think more and more countries will look at producing at least essentials by themselves. And I don't know if that's how that will fit with their economies, but I think it's a very tough lesson that we all are, seeing now. BCG is the TB vaccine that is given to newborn kids in endemic countries. It protects just the kids, the newborn babies, till the age of 2 or 3 years of age. It doesn't protect any of us, as some of us, including Jerry, learned on the hard way. The fact that we are vaccinated doesn't mean that we will not get the disease or the infection. And recently there were comments saying that the TB vaccine, this BCG, potentially protects against COVID. And because obviously nobody knows, it was observed more at the level of correlation. People saw that countries that have vaccination in place seems to have less cases or less deaths. You need the evidence for that. And that's why India, Germany, Australia, and now South Africa are embarking into doing some of this research to observe that and to see if it's true. So that's the study that I said the South African colleagues are keen to put. They started already funding it from their own pockets, and they need further resources to do it. Even if it says no, it doesn't work, it's fine, because we at least know something for sure. Because as I said before, the problem with this COVID on us is we don't know almost anything. So we need to start saying no to some things. That's not working, that's working, but at least have some certitudes. Jerry, we have 1 minute.
So can I just yes. say, let's just again confirm, BCG is busy work. They're busy work. It is not a vaccine. So many of us are beginning to jump onto this bandwagon and that bandwagon. So let's just confirm, this is research being done. BCG is not the cure. Everyone is looking, and this is just one of the avenues being investigated.
Yes. So Jerry, your closing comments.
Just Luchika and the Stop TB Partnership, thank you for everything that you're doing. Thank you for still remaining focused on our TB communities across the country. As you know, I'm here if you need me. Our TB communities need all of us now to band together to ensure that they are protected from these dual pandemics. So let's keep doing what we do.
Thank you, Jerry. I'm very honored as every time to be in touch with you. I'm happy you took the time for us. I'm happy you take the time for your fellow South African friends and colleagues every day. We will continue doing a series of discussions like this with famous friends and champions from other countries as well. But we know that in South Africa, we rely on you. And for everyone listening there, the only thing that COVID managed in a positive way is that I think the TB community is coming together more solid than ever, working together. I feel we are shoulder to shoulder more than before with whatever organization. And I think that will be just good for people with TB. So with this, I think we are done with the time. Thank you very much, Jerry. Kiss to your mom and to your daughter that is home with you and to you. And thank you.
We'll see you soon.
See you soon.
If it's online or in person, we'll see each other soon.
Yes. See you soon and hug you soon. That will be the most, the beautiful.
I'll hug myself for you.
Yes.
Bye, my good friend.
Thank you so much, Jerry. Thank you so much.
Bye.